tours it too. And so if you want to meet her and be able to talk to her a little bit more closely, then come at 2 o'clock on Sunday for her tours it too. And then next Wednesday, it is Paula's month. She is going to do the Munch and Learn. She's going to be talking about, of course, the inspiration from her art and how she does all those incredible little stitches, very precise stitches. And also, can you believe all the things we have going on? Saturday, February 24th, we have our Mindfully Looking at Art program. And so if you want to come and kind of have a meditative lesson on looking at art, well, then come for that. It's absolutely free, and it is from 10 to 10:30. So, now finally, we're to today. And Kevin likes really short introductions. So, please welcome the Linda W. and S. Berkeley Director of the Dixon, Kevin Short.
I'll say this, Paula's work, you know, I'm not, you know me, I mean, we all know each other by now, I'm a paintings guy, you know, I love paintings, I just can't get enough of them, and so which makes me slightly skeptical of everything else, and high up on my list of things I'm skeptical of is actually textiles. You know, it's, you know, we all have our biases, and mine's as ridiculous as anybody else's, but I'm absolutely in love with this show. This work is like, it's just blown my mind. So spend a little time in Paula's show. You'll be rewarded for it. Like I said, I came to it as a bit of a skeptic, and it just knocked me out. I mean, they're like abstract paintings, and they're smart, and they remind me of other artists' work who I admire, and yada, yada, yada. You know, Lindley, I've got everything I need up here except for that thing that that changed. Well, we can just look at this for all that. Anyway, while Lindley's getting this, just let me take this opportunity to say Happy Valentine's Day to everyone. You know, I don't say this often enough, but I love you guys. And thank you. Well, couldn't possibly have handed that to me without a little beer. All right. And I'd also like to say, this is a great thing to get started. I've been rewarded for my efforts at Munch and Learn with a packet of cookies that this nice young gentleman brought to me. And I've seen him at lots of Munch and Learns. And thank you very much. You keep coming. And the rest of you, look and learn. Thank you. So, just like virtually, every piece of music, every pop song, every bit of classical music, just about every work of art is mostly about love, in one way or another. Nancy Trentham, who always puts these Munch and Learns PowerPoints together for me, has put one of her favorites, which is Cupid and Psyche, a sculpture that's in the collection of the Louvre. Is it antiquity or is it, we don't know. If it is, nice. And you can see, it's kind of all about love. And love filters through so many works of art, from the pre-Raphaelites, to Dante Gabriel Rossetti, to, of course, our friend Rodin, and his famous sculpture of the Kiss. And one of my favorite prints of the 19th century, Edvard Munch's The Kiss. It's just this beautiful, beautiful woodcut. I've always loved the way, those two heads actually just merge. You know, it's more than just a kiss, it's the union of, it's the union of two people. And then, of course, Gustav Klimt's The Kiss as well, one of the most famous works of art to embrace the theme. And even right up into the late 20th century, where even Andy Warhol had a soft spot. So what we're going to do today is move through some of my favorite artistic romances. They're not necessarily the greatest or the most important, but they're the ones that I found interesting, that, ca- that ca- captured my attention. One of the, and you know, some of them are sweet, some of them are not so sweet. You know, it's just, they're just relationships that have somehow, you know, captured my attention. And one of them is, one of the best is Marc Chagall and his marriage to Bella Roosevelt, which takes place in the early 20th century. And here they are together. Look how they love each other. You can just see it, can't you? You know, just the affection. And it goes both ways. They're the sweetest people in the world. This is probably a photograph from the 1920s. I'm guessing they're, you know, Chagall is born in Belarus, near the city of Vitebsk, and so is Bella. She's from the same region. They meet, and it's absolutely love at first sight. It's one of those situations. This is quite a few years later. So they meet in 1909, and by this time Chagall is beginning to make a name for himself in Russia as a painter, and he does what most aspiring artists do, and that is go to Paris. He goes to Paris, you know, sometime around 1909. He actually meets Bella in 1909, and he's a little bit reluctant to go when he knows he has to go. And he arrives in Paris and almost immediately begins to make a significant name for himself. And he does it by tapping into, you know, all the things that, you know, that we know about Chagall. You know, he's looking at his upbringing in Belarus, his life. You know, he's very poor. You know, he doesn't come from a prosperous family at all. He draws on his Jewish heritage, and that informs his work. And there's a kind of mystical quality that filters through his painting, and it's very laden with symbolism. And you can see it, and it, like I said, it always seems to refer back in very kind of tangible ways to the place that he comes from. And he's also one of the most brilliant colorists of his age. You know, he's immersed in the Paris of his time. So when he paints Eye in the Village in 1911, yes, he's looking back to his own youth in Belarus, in Russia, but what else is he looking at? He's definitely thinking about Bella, but he's also looking at the work of Pablo Picasso. You know, can you see the sort of cubist elements coming through in the work? But more than that, he's also looking at the work of maybe who else? Maybe Henri Matisse? You know, I think that intense color that we see in Chagall's work is probably influenced by exhibitions of the group of painters that were known as the Vogues. Matisse, George Braque for a while, André Durand, Vlaminck, lots of others are really exploring the pushing the boundaries, especially, and Matisse is the prototype. You know, Matisse is the one who's really pushing the envelope on what color can do in a painting. And so when you look at Eye in the Village, and of course the man has a green face and the goat, you know, is fragmented in a kind of cubist way, and here we go. But if you, once you get past that, look at the intensity of that color in the background. You know, I mean, that's probably straight out of the tube. So anyway, so he's painting Eye in the Village. He's in Paris. Bella's back in Russia, and he's missing her terribly. He's having some success. This is a beautiful, I love this painting. This is a Paris Through the Window, 1913. And I think that, you know, I'm a sucker for any painting with a cat that has a human head. That's just me. But look at this, you know, look at this right there. He's holding his heart in his hand, or a heart in his hand. And, you know, what's he doing right here? What do you see? I mean, he's not two-faced, I wouldn't say. That's not what he's all about. I would say he's doing what?
He's looking
forward and backward at the same time. And so, you know, in 1930, and he's, you know, obviously making it clear where he is. I don't know quite why this train is running upside down, but it is. And it, again, Russian peasants are floating through the air. Floating things will factor quite prominently in his work. He's thinking about it's time to get back to Russia. It's time to get back to Bella. He's very worried. I mean, he considers himself engaged to her from the moment they meet. But the question is, does she feel the same way? You know, it's now been 4 years. How many of you women would feel the same way after 4 years? I'd say, that's all of you, right? Not a hand went up. All right. Well, there's Aaron Greer. So anyway, by about the time he's making this painting, he's really starting to achieve some success, and he has been offered an exhibition at the Kasserer Gallery in Berlin. And Kasserer is a major, major leader. This is an important step in his career. And so he heads to Berlin in 1914, and he figures as long as he's in Berlin, he'll just continue on to Russia. And here's another painting from 1913, and I'm a fiddler dancing on the roof. Mind anybody of any kind? Anybody seen Fiddler on the Roof lately? You know, yeah. I mean, it really does kind of tap into. I mean, if you watch that movie with fairly intentional eyes, you're gonna see, and you look through, just spend a day looking through a book. Spend an hour looking through a book of Chagall's work, and then watch that film in particular. You'll see lots and lots of parallels. This was no accident at all. Even though, you know, Chagall's making his painting in 1913, and Fiddler on the Roof was written in 1962. That's how strong the influence of Chagall's work is. Yeah. And so, anyway, he's in Berlin. The show's a great success, but. 1914 is a challenging year in Europe, as we all know. In August of that year, Germany and France, it's the start of World War I, basically. And we know all about that because our Mr. Dixon was working in the cotton business in Bremen at that same time, and he is eventually arrested as an enemy alien and spends the entirety of the war in an internment camp in just outside of Berlin. So our Mr. Dixon and young Marc Chagall, Mr. Dixon was probably about 10 years younger than Marc Chagall, crossed paths right there in Berlin. But Chagall manages to get out of Berlin and back to his home in Russia. And this is one of the first paintings he makes, and it's a birthday present for Bella. And, you know, they are, I mean, it's obviously him and obviously her. They're more, even more naturalistically portrayed in this. I mean, they're more obviously portraits of Chagall and Bella than Kahinda Wiley, and this portrait is obviously a portrait of Barack Obama. You know, it's that the likeness is that similar. And again, you know, it's love. They're floating together through space and through time. You know, this is actually the city that they live in. We know it from this, you know, this church in the background. And it's just a marvelous work. So, you know, what he hopes is going to be a short time back in Russia turns into about 10 years. You know, starting with World War I, and then, you know, the Russian Revolution. That's also not so helpful to their plans. He gets out of Russia in about 1922, but he doesn't get back to Paris until 1924. Here's just another painting of the two of them. I mean, it becomes the great leitmotif of his work. All of his work is about this kind of faith in the power of love. And I like this particular painting from 1928. It reminds me of our own painting from 1927. Look at how, you know, the still life in the background. I mean, he's obviously looking at some of the same some of the And of course, there's always, you know, the goat playing violin, which, you know, love isn't love if there's not a goat playing the violin. And it, I mean, the goat is full of all kinds of symbolism that, that actually cuts both ways, both from the, in terms of his Jewish faith, but also the goat is often a symbol of a carnal kind of love as well. And so we're happy for them that they have it both ways. and then they are in the Paris studio, and that's their daughter right behind Marshall. I mean, he's still painting, but this is probably, I mean, the daughter is, how old is that little girl, do you think? 10? You know, so this is probably painted about the same time that he paints Our Still Life painting, you're about 27, 28, and he's still painting her with such affection. And why would look? I mean, she's beautiful, he's just completely enamored of her, they have this incredible life. And look what's sitting on an easel in the background. Remember this? So that many years later, I mean that's I think how powerful that reunion might have been. And then this is our painting, another one of our, we own two works by Chagall. So Chagall has this, you know, he has this very solid career in the 1920s and into the 1930s. He's a bit of an international art star. But you know, the years 1914, 15, 16, 17, 18 were troubled. The 1930s for a Jew in Europe were even more perilous. He and Bella try to get out and are arrested in Marseille in 1941. They stay longer than they should have, but his stature is enough that he's able to be released, and he does find his way to the United States. And spends about 7 or 8 years in New York. And at first he just hates it. You know, he doesn't speak the language. I mean, there are just lots of things about, you know, he misses his life. He doesn't hate it because he's not recognized in the, and there are of course many, many other European immigrants in New York at the same time. And he begins to feel more comfortable there as he meets people like Pete Montreal and other artists. But then in 1944, Bella gets sick. I mean, not seriously, you know, she has a sore throat, you know, but it turns into an infection. And she just gets sicker and sicker and sicker, and Chagall is just mad and worried. And in as famous as he is, as rich as he is, really, relatively speaking, during the by this point in his career, there's nothing he can do. There are rationing. It's the war, and she can't get the medication that she needs. And in 1944, that year in September, she dies. You know, something that the simplest of medicines. I mean, there were things that she could have taken. I mean, it wasn't like one of those things where, you know, penicillin hadn't been invented yet. They just couldn't get it. And it's kind of understandable that it's heartbreaking. And so our pain is, you know, she has just died. It's from 1945. It's just taken only months. He goes into a kind of depression, but it's still, you know, but he still has faith and love. It's with Bella. They're floating through the cosmos. You know, I mean, he's still, you know, still painting flowers. They're still a romantic couple. But look at this. I've always found this interesting. And of course, you know, you need the goat. But this architecture, I think he's alluding to New York. You know, we're not looking at Russia, you know, anymore. I mean, it will return, but in this moment, that's the architecture we're seeing. So I've always felt like we have a rather poignant painting by Chagall in this work. And then you may not know this about me, but I'm incredibly sentimental, and I like kind of syrupy, drippy movies. And And, you know, and if some of them speak with a British accent, sometimes it'll put me right to sleep. But sometimes, I just really, really like him. And I like Hugh Grant. You know, he's kind of, he's kind of a doofus, but, you know, but he's got a winning way. And Notting Hill is really kind of a favorite. And there's this moment in Notting Hill. You know the story? Has everyone seen Notting Hill?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, he owns a bookstore. She's a famous movie star. You know, they bump into each other somehow, and, you know, this kind of chemistry, this unlikely chemistry ensues. And at some point, they're sitting in his apartment, and he has a poster, you know, of this Chagall painting of, you know, of a bride, you know, sitting next, again, to a goat playing the violin. And, you know, and she says, you can see the text on that's a screenshot from the movies, yeah, it feels like love. How love should be floating through a dark blue sky, which is exactly what you see in our painting, floating through a dark blue sky. But it also gives you a sense of just how meaningful Chagall can be. I mean, and how powerful his love to Bella really, you know, influenced his work, you know, influenced his life choices. But, you know, but that still resonates with people, even, you know, making kind of syrupy movies in the 1990s or whenever this movie was made. And it's an actual painting. You know, and in the movie, she gives him the painting. Now, she just handed him about $2 million, you know. I don't know if that's really, you know, I like you, but... that's a statement, you know. Anyway, it's based on a real painting. This work is in a private collection in Japan. So anyway, Chagall is just one of these really delightful artists. He comes back to Europe in about 1947-48. Has this great romance with Pablo Picasso. You know, Picasso hated artists, you know, he saw everyone as a rival, and he was particularly savage with anyone from his own generation or any other generation. but he liked Chagall, and he said, when Matisse dies in 1954, he says of Chagall, Chagall is the last artist on the planet who knows anything about color. And for Picasso, that was truly high praise. So my next favorite, I like Chagall a lot. I do. I like it a lot because it's sweet and sad, and, you know, it'd be a great movie and all that stuff. But you know, I really like Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo because that's a complicated relationship. You know, and it already is a movie. You know, a couple of them, okay. So, and here they are. And, you know, it's easy to see what she saw in him. You know, I'm gonna start working on this belly. You know, he's about, you know, he, in all seriousness, he, you know, he's a formidable guy. She's just a young painter starting out. I mean, albeit an incredibly inventive and talented painter starting out. But he's a lion. He's the greatest, when she meets him, he's 20 years older than she is, and he's the greatest painter in Mexico. I mean, undisputed. And he is. He's brilliant. You know, he's already, this was always one of my favorite paintings, The Collection of the Art Institute of Chicago. I mean, he's already absorbed Cubism, you know. I mean, he's trained in Mexico and then he trains again in Europe, and he spends a lot of time in Paris, and he just soaks it all up. You know, he's got Cubism, he's got all the styles down. That's what a young artist should do. And this work from just a couple of years later, and I threw it in front of a window. And so he's not really doing it in chronological order, but, you know, he's absorbed Picasso. He's looking at probably Cezanne and trying to find his own voice in it. And then in about 19, 22, something like that. He travels in, he travels throughout Italy, and he's looking at frescoes, and you know, Italian Renaissance. He's going from one Italian. He goes to all the churches in Italy, and I mean, he couldn't possibly go to all of them. He goes to a lot of them. And what he brings back is this kind of vision for his own country. He sees in the frescoes of the Italian Renaissance a kind of authenticity, a realness, a sense of spirituality and identity. It goes way beyond. It goes way beyond faith, because he's an atheist. He has no faith, particularly, you know. But it's impossible not to be moved by that work. And he comes back, and it's really the founder of the Mexican Muralist Project that will absorb not only Mexico, and it, you know, I mean, those paintings are just so amazing. If you're in Mexico, do a little research, find the murals by Rivera especially. Don't miss any of them that you can see, but also, you know, Orozco's, Caro's, and these are just powerful works, and they're works for the people. I mean, this is not long after the end of the Mexican Revolution. So these are works of art that speak to the whole of the nation, no matter what your station in life. And this is, I just pulled this this particular detail from one of his murals in 1923 in Mexico City, because it's these women from Tehuantepec, which is in Oaxaca, in southern Mexico, and they're wearing the traditional garb, and he's particularly attracted to this. You know, it becomes a kind of index of authenticity to him, and of matriarchy, you know, which he also kind of has some faith in. And so when he meets Frida Kahlo, about the same time, maybe he meets her in about, this photograph was taken in, the Kahlo family was taken in 1926, when Frida's about 19 years old. And that's Frida right there. Yeah. So there's, and I have no idea what she's doing, really. But you know, this thing with identity, with her and identity, is going to be incredibly, incredibly fluid. This is her sister, Christina, right there. Right here, seated on the right, who's only 11 months younger than Frida and her whole family. And Frida, of course, her father was a photographer. So, I mean, she comes out, and she has polio as a child. And here, like I said, she's 19 years old, and she's about to be in a horrific, horrific accident. She's on a bus that's hit by a trolley. Her spine is crushed. Her pelvis is broken. And she's actually impaled by some chunk of metal. I mean, the fact that she survived is miraculous. Miraculous. But she does. And it's all in about this moment of 1926. I don't know whether this is before or after the accident. I would venture to guess it was before. But you can see, look at who she is now. I mean, she's wearing fashionable clothing, she's elegant, she's a little bit risque, she's exquisitely beautiful, which she was. And interesting, you know, I would say of all the artists I know, and this isn't self-absorption, this is something else, I don't know quite what it is, but you know, there may be, you know, and she doesn't have a large body of work. In part because, you know, Diego's not all that, you know, he's supportive of her work, but not if you know, cuts into the time that she's taken care of. He is supportive of her work, but she maybe only makes 200 paintings in her career. And of those 200, at least 50, maybe more, are self-portraits. And like I said, this isn't about vanity, it's about something else. It really is, you know, it's because she will, here she's portrayed herself, and, you know, as beautiful as she is, she's young, she's beautiful, you know, she's maybe 20 years old here. But but she also has no problem, you know, emphasizing that unibrow that was no, you know, it's not necessarily any more attractive then than it is now. And here, you know, it was 1929, she has met Diego at this point. Their relationship is just starting. And you can see that she's now no longer in European costume. Note this necklace, you're going to see it again and again and again. I mean, it probably reflects on, as a reflection of something. It's probably contemporary jewelry, but it clearly relates to, I mean, something Aztecian or Mayan. I don't know the stuff well enough to identify. But she takes on this persona that Rivera is attracted to, and which turns up again and again in his work. And then here they are in 1931. And this is the year when they have this kind of breakthrough, when the Mexican mural movement begins to be recognized very, very clearly as something powerful and important. And Diego and Frida go to the United States, and they're there from 1931 to 1934. And they're first brought to San Francisco in 1931. And this is a double portrait that Frida paints of the two of them. And up here, I should have done the details. I thought it'd be more legible. A little bird brings in a ribbon, and on it is written, "This is me," this in Spanish. "This is me, Frida, with my beloved husband, Diego Rivera," and this painting is for Albert Bender, who was a major patron of the arts in San Francisco. It was said that if you wrote on an envelope and just said "St. Albert, San Francisco, California," it would get there. Wow. He was one of the great patrons of the art. And then it's dated April of 1931. And this is the kind of work this was one of the first murals that Diego produces when he's in. And it's a scene, you know? I mean, it's not just Diego, you know, up on the ladder painting this stuff. I mean, they arrange for, it's always dozens of studio assistants and helpers, and they're painting, this is painted in a traditional fresco manner. So they're mixing plaster and pigments, and it's happening. I mean, it all has to happen so quickly. And the thing that you may not recognize, I mean, they're always about workers. And this mural still exists. And, you know, this is painted. The scaffolding, it's a brilliant, brilliant illusion. At least I find it such. And so he does two murals in 1931 and 1932 in San Francisco. Maybe there's actually a third of them too. I think there might be. And then he goes to Detroit. Anybody ever been to the Detroit Institute of Arts? Yeah. Those murals, just phenomenal. I mean, they're worth. The Rivera murals and the Detroit Institute of Art are worth the trip all by itself. And then while you're there, you're in like the fifth largest art museum in the country, and so that's pretty impressive as well. And then from there, Diego goes on to New York, where of all people, to commission a communist painter, the Rockefellers wanted to do a mural in Rockefeller Center. About the clash. And I mean, and the mural got done. The mural, it happened. He's in there painting. He's got, you know, among his studio assistants is the great American painter Ben Shawn. I mean, there are many, many others that take part in this thing. But then, I'm going to set things down so I can give you a steady hand. But then what he does is add this guy. You know who that is? Yeah, Vladimir Lenin. Can you imagine how that went over? The Rockefellers are just, I'll say this for capitalists, and some of my best friends are capitalists. you know, I mean, they tried to reason with him. You know, Nelson Rockefeller had one conversation after another after another. It's like, we love it. You're a great artist. This is a, you know, this painting was called Man at the Crossroads. And, you know, there's this figure here, and, you know, all the armies and scholars and builders and sculptors are all, you know, it's the whole human comedy right here before us. We love it. We love everything about it. You gotta paint out Lynn. You know, I mean, it's Nelson Rockefeller for crying out loud. He's not, you know, I mean, these are incredible patrons of the arts, but even they have limits, and Diego absolutely refuses, which is kind of what you want Diego to do. You know, he is a man of principle, and those principles are not going to waver. I don't care if you are Nelson. You know, John Dean would go near it. You know, he sent his, you know, John Dean Jr., he sent his son. Anyway, it's, and so, they destroyed it. They destroyed it. And then pulled it off the wall, threw it in the trash. Yeah. I think Diego got paid. So, how does this color photograph of it make sense? Well, here's how. Diego goes back to, after 1934, I mean, this is not really good for Diego's career necessarily, but you know, he goes back, so they kind of limp back home to Mexico City. They've been in the United States for 3 years, and Diego is commissioned to paint the same mural in the Palacio de Bellas Artes in Mexico City. It's smaller, but it's basically the same mural, and I think Lennon is a little bit, there black and white photographs exist of the Rockefeller Center mural. They're not, they're kind of grainy and you can't really see it all that well, but they do exist. But, and so this is a little bit compressed, but we also, not only do we get Lennon, we get Karl Marx over here, we get Engels, we got the whole Marxist crew. It's a fabulous setting. If you're ever in Mexico City, don't miss it. I saw it for the first time, maybe 3 years ago, and, you know, still talking about it.
How big is
it? It's big. I mean, it's big as that wall, probably. And it's in this beautiful, loggia setting. I mean, the only problem is you can't get back from it, because it's a loggia around the central court. But, you know, I mean, it's just kind of an amazing thing. And so this is Frida's sister, Christina. So they're back in, you know, the happy couple. They're back in Mexico. Things are going very well. But then Diego here, lover boy Diego, foolishly, hang on, let me go back. You know, has an affair with Frida's sister. Really well played. Really well played. So, you know, that doesn't go well at all. The marriage is that happens in about 1937. The marriage is definitely struggling. See, they're kissing in 33. I came work in 37. And here's how Frida responds to 1937 with a self-portrait with her beating heart pumping the blood out of her very system laying on the ground. You know, here's the school dress from her childhood. Here's the kind of costume that Diego would like to see her in. And here she is wearing European dress with her hands cut off so she can't paint anymore. And this thing going right through where her heart used to be. Anybody have any trouble reading this thing? And that's what I'm talking about. They're self-portraits. I mean, it's not a matter of vanity, as much as you might think. So, Frida and Diego, I mean, it's hard to argue the nature of their influence in Mexico. They're huge. They're huge celebrities. They're like Beyonce and whoever Beyonce is married to. You know, they're that would be who?
Jay-Z.
Yeah, I knew it. I was just playing with it. Anyway. And so, they meet Trotsky. I mean, they do more than meet Trotsky. They persuade the president of Mexico to give Trotsky, Leon Trotsky, the great ideologue, the great, you know, the great leader of the Russian Revolution, sanctuary in Mexico. I mean, he's been, you know, he's, I mean, just a very quick sketch of his impressive life. Trotsky leads the Red Army during the Revolution. Trotsky defeats the Tsarist White Army, the army that wants to try to keep the Tsars in power. And he is, I mean, he's not only a brilliant tactician and soldier, he's also a brilliant writer, and he manages the propaganda in the early 1920s of the new Soviet state. But Lenin is, of course, the undisputed power in Soviet.